Respected Chief Guest, Ms. Sandhya Rao, Guest Speakers, Mr. Murli Dharan, Mr. Venkatesh, Mr. Suresh Krishnamurti Rao, Ms. Chitra Rangaraj, friends and well-wishers. Good evening and a hearty welcome to all who have gathered here for the launch of the revised edition of Madhawas of Madras as part of the Madras Week celebrations. I request all the Chief Guests to please come and take a seat on the dais. About our Honorable Chief Guest, Ms. Sandhya Rao. Ms. Sandhya Rao is a writer and editor with many years of experience in mainstream media and publishing, having worked at the Indian Express, India Today, Frontline, The Hindu's Business Line, Tata McGraw-Hill, and Tulika Publishers. She worked on an exhibition curated by artist Chandraleka on women called Stree as part of the Festival of India in Moscow. Among the many books she has written for children are popular titles such as Ekki Dokki, My Friend, The Sea, My Mother's Sari, and Dream Writer. She regularly writes columns for Business Line on campus and Rotary News. She conducts writing workshops and also teaches at the Crescent School of Business, Chennai. A hearty welcome to you. May I now request our Chief Guest, Ms. Sandhya Rao, to release the book. Ms. Chitra Rangaraj, Senior Journalist and Associate Editor of News Today, will receive the first copy. I deem it a great honor to receive Meera's book. I don't know why she chose me, not just because I'm a journalist, but I think because I'm a good friend of hers. And I've had some very good Madhwa friends in my lifetime. Beginning with Mr. Ramanand's family. He was the chairman of the railway board, and his son was my colleague in Indian Express. So we had a great relationship even outside the office. And you must have heard about the Mylapore trio also, who are into promoting culture in Mylapore and Chennai. So they've been great friends. They've been associated with me for about 20 years now, I think. And Meera and I go way back. Must be some 20 years, Meera. Our friendship must be some 20 years old and still going strong. And the best thing about them is, about the Madhwas, I think, is that they integrate themselves with wherever they live. Isn't that a salient point, Meera, in your book, that you find that wherever they are, they integrate themselves with the society there. So, very happy to be here. Thank you. Thank you, ma'am. So wherever they are, they integrate themselves. That's a wonderful point, and I think it's the takeaway for the rest of us. I now request our chief guest, Mr. Sandhya Rao, to speak about the book.
Thank you. First of all, I have to say congratulations, Meera. Being a member of the publishing fraternity, I know how difficult it is. How difficult it is to conduct, you know, to actually meet people and do interviews on your own. And if you have commissioned, if you have asked, requested people to write about somebody or contribute an article, how terribly difficult it is to, you know, get the article, get it out of them in time. So please give Meera a big round of applause. This is a revised edition, so Meera has put in extra effort to include more people. The first edition had about, highlighted the contributions of about 50 individuals. This one has almost 70 individuals, and I look forward to a third revised edition in which there will be very many more people. Chitra made a very interesting observation that Madhavas have a way of integrating themselves wherever they are, and I think that is so true. You know, and I, because one question I personally have been asked very, very often is, okay, but what are you? So then, you know, you try to explain what you are, and I give up. I mean, I usually always say I'm Indian, you know, and leave it at that. But some people persist, and then you explain that, you know, you have X, you have Y, and you have us, we are Z. So I think it used to irritate me when I was much younger that people asked a question like this, because we've been around for hundreds of years. So why do people still keep asking this question? Then as more gray hairs kind of appeared in my on my head, I realized that it's because, yes, we integrate. We become so much part of wherever we're living that, we don't aspire to stand out separately. We want to be part of society, be an inextricable part of society. At the same time, we also have our own identity. And I think Meera, in bringing in highlighting the contributions of several individuals, draws attention to the fact of our identity. And I think this is, in a way, an example for the rest of the country, you know, how to preserve your identity, yet be part of the whole. And I think we should all be proud of that. I just thought I would read a few passages from some of the contributions of the book, just to give you a taste of what you will encounter when you read, and the kind of interesting stories that you will read, and the interesting people you will come to know. For instance, you will have to excuse me if some of the relatives of some of the people from whose lives I'm reading out are here, and I don't recognize them. If you could just, that would be nice, because then it gives you a sense of belonging. So please excuse me for that support. I know some of you, but I don't know everybody. For instance, in Palle Chansalarao Panthulu's, the contribution about him, he was in the Indian Civil Service, well, during British times, okay? He was born in 1832. So he was in the civil services at that time. And he writes to his son, Krishna Rao, who was also in the administrative service. He says, when his son was a deputy collector in 1891, PCR as he was known, he wrote to his son, Krishna Rao, "Greatness consists in knowledge and goodness in deeds. Try to acquire both. Do not go to bed any day until you are sure that you are wiser than yesterday. Be always humble and open to conviction, but never be timid to express your opinion. Do not court popularity or applause at the expense of rectitude. It is your duty to do and say what you think to be right, and it is the people's business to be pleased with you or not. It does not matter if you are misunderstood. I think these are brave words, and I think this advice, you know, applies to every individual and every generation, our generation and the next and the following, because we live in troubled times today, and it is hard, getting harder and harder to actually say what is in our minds, to be brave, to be bold, and to speak our minds, but to speak it diplomatically without hurting people's feelings. So there's a lot of that is contained in this piece of advice that he gives. Let me just read a little bit from Woodland's Krishna Rao's little sketch. He was born in 1898, and his father was an archaka of the Sri Subramanya temple. So they lived in Udupi, and as his father, with his meager earnings, couldn't afford to give a decent life to Krishna Rao and his siblings, the former was taken out of school to take up various jobs for supplementing the family's income. His meeting with his sister's groom, Rangana, who was running a restaurant in Madras, proved the turning point in his life, where Krishna Rao literally seized an opportunity under the nose of his younger brother, Madhavaraja, who was originally planned by his father, who always thought he was a smarter one, to accompany Rangana on his return to Madras. Hopes of making it big in a big city were soon dashed when he had to toil throughout the day for a monthly salary of 5 rupees as domestic help with a railway officer in Gambuchetti Street. He walked out one day to join a vegetarian restaurant, Sharda Vilas Brahmin's Hotel, which was grand only in name, as a kitchen boy for 8 rupees a month. And as the work involved more drudgery, he waited for the first opportunity to quit. And it came when Raghana was going to Tirthani to do business. He took Krishna Rao with him. And soon the latter realized he had exchanged one intolerable situation for another. However, it was not to last long, as he was fortunate to find employment almost immediately when a man from his part of South Canara had opened a restaurant in Post Office Street off Tambuchetti Street and invited Krishna Rao to work for him on a salary of 20 rupees, a big leap from 8 rupees. Though the work was no better, the consolation was that he graduated to the status of junior cook. Then something that he had not imagined worked in his favor. The owner, not very successful in running the second restaurant he had opened, noticed the potential in this youngster and offered to sell it to him for 700 rupees to be paid in monthly installments of 50 rupees. Placing his trust in his personal god, Subramanya, he took the plunge, becoming his own master at last, and began to explore possibilities of his further growth in the hospitality industry. And we know where this decision took him. I'm sure there's no one here who hasn't been to Woodlands. I mean, and definitely more than, I don't know, several times, right? At one time, that was the place everybody went to. As college students, that's where we went. And college students today continue to go to Woodlands. And it has grown. Of course, it's seen ups and downs. But this is how, how Woodlands began. This is the story of how Woodlands began. Then let's take a quick look at, there is, in Royapata you have Balaji Nagar, okay? Balaji Nagar, I mean some of you will know, Balaji Nagar is named after R. Balaji Rao, a lawyer, a Madhwa lawyer. Now his story is also interesting. I love stories and I love listening to stories, so I have to share these stories with you. Nyan Rao Pant of Bijapur came to South India with Chhatrapati Shivaji in the year 1678 and was employed as Subedar of Manarguri near Tanjavur. His descendants, Sri Jeevan Rao and Sri Ram Rao, were employed in Tanjavur and Kumbakonam. Sri Ram Rao's son, Balaji Rao, was born in Kumbakonam in 1842. So these are real stalwarts, you know, way back, under, you know, they kind of took their lives into their own hands and carved out their own destinies. That took a lot of courage. He had his initial education in Kumbakonam, passed intermediate exam then, known as FA in the Government Arts College, Kumbakonam. He was very eager to pursue higher studies. And since his small hometown did not offer much scope for his ambition of higher studies, he decided to proceed to Madras. As he could not afford to travel to Madras, which was about 200 miles away, so you can convert that in kilometers, he decided to walk all the way to Madras. En route, when he was taking rest on the outskirts of Kadalur, a villager who was coming on his bullock cart loaded with paddy offered him a lift. Balaji Rao got down from the bullock cart near Porsavakam in Madras city. A passing Christian priest happened to see him and, impressed by his looks and personality, took him along, and after a short interview, Balaji Rao was appointed to teach English and arithmetic in a school in Vepari. He worked as a teacher in the school for 2 years, and he was so studious that he wanted to utilize his time fully for the betterment of his knowledge and career during the evening hours. So what did he do? He studied law. And that is your lawyer, Balaji Rao. Isn't that amazing? I mean, a story like that is, you know, gives me goosebumps. Because I think, wow, you know, and we kind of course times have changed and some things are easier, some things are not easier. But these are stories from which you can draw so much inspiration. And I feel a book like this needs to be shared with young people, you know, so that they know where their grandparents and their great-grandparents came from and the kind of lives they led. And they get a sense of what kind of personalities they were. Okay, I won't read anymore because I'll leave you to read, discover these gems yourselves. But I would like to just say, Suresh is here. Suresh's father, Krishnamurti Rao Kittu, is my father's cousin. And I remember my mother, when she got married, she came into this family and she met Kittu. Kittu was a youngster, maybe he was about 11 or 12 years old, and my mother had just got married. And then later, when I grew up, every time, you know, we spoke about Kittu or we met him, she would tell me, you know, the very first time I met him, I knew he was going to do something special. He had that spark in his eyes. So, you know, it just sort of gives you such a lovely feeling inside to know that there are stories like, oh, but this story isn't in this book. But when you find out, when you discover more about these people, you discover all these stories as well. In fact, I do interact a lot with small children, and I always encourage them to talk to their grandparents, to granduncles and grandaunts, and ask them what it was like when they were young, their friends, you know, what it was like when they went to school. Did they go to school at all? What did they do in their spare time? You know, so to get a sense of, because, you know, what is history but our personal stories, as well as the collective story of a community, a region, a nation, the world. So I would encourage all of you, I see a young man sitting there, to talk to people, to older people in your family, and get these stories, because they will, I tell you, they will inspire you. I have to share one more little incident, and then, you know, I teach, as was pointed out, I teach students at the Chennai School of Business. And as one of the exercises, I brought the entire class home, you know, to meet my mother. And my mother is not an entrepreneur. She's a grandmother, and right now she's frail, she's grown old. But she has seen, she's 84 now, so she's seen so many changes in India. So they came with their heads hanging and kind of bored looks, but because ma'am said they had to come, you know, they had to sort of tumble out of the bus and come and meet her. The exercise was, I only said she's my mother. The exercise was that they would try and find out whatever they could about her by asking her questions. And believe me, At the end of an hour and a half, they didn't want to leave. You know, that's what it's like talking to people, you know, and getting stories from them. So Meera, again from the bottom of my heart, I would say congratulations. There's just one little thing that I'd like to add and that I'd like to see in the next revised edition of the book. One is photographs of the individuals that you have spoken about. That would be really nice. And if as many stories, as many contributions as possible could be expanded with a few more anecdotes about the kind of lives they led. I know it's going to be a headache for you and you'll become grayer than you are, but it will be worth it. And the third thing is, I would love to see more women represented in this book. So thank you, enjoy.
Thank you, ma'am, for sharing all those valuable insights and letting us have a glimpse into the lives of people who have carved a niche for themselves. That was wonderful. Thank you. It's my pleasure now to introduce Mr. V. Muralidharan, founder of an NGO. Mr. Muralidharan worked in the software industry for 25 years, founded Sevalia, a charity organization, in 1988. He gave up his job at TCS in 2009 and has been fully engaged in charity work through Sevalia. His specialties: he has the unique combination of knowing the latest processes required to run a software project and also experience in running a charity based on the principles of Gandhi, Bharati and Vivekananda. Therefore, he is able to apply his project management knowledge to running a charity which has given very good results. From the corporate world to the world of charitable acts, sir, please let us have some glimpses about Sevalia, the temple of service.
First of all, thank you, Meera madam, for inviting me. I can't understand how she found out that I'm a Madhawas. I have not so much into Madhawas circles or anything like that. But I think, you know, she has been searching for people who she can write about in the race tradition. So somehow, you know, she got the link and she found out. And one day I got a call and she said she wanted to talk to me. And before the race, when you come and see Sevalia, you know, people talking to me, you see what the work that is going on. You know, what they're talking to me is what you come and see is going to be, you know, more interesting. And she made a trip, you know, spent the whole full day, you know, visiting our center. And then we had a chat, and in this book there is something written about Sevalia. So I'm very happy about that. Just before this meeting started, my mother has also come. So she asked me in which language I wanted to speak. Because she is a Maharashtrian, she is a Marathi Madhava. And if I speak in Marathi, I don't know, how many of you will understand this Marathi. This is Marathi version 7.0, I think, after 7 generations of, you know, coming into Chennai. And my father is a Kannadiga, so I can speak Kannada also. My Kannada is much better than my Marathi because I studied in India of Science. So I spent some time in Bangalore where my, you know, Kannada got repaired. My wife is a Tamil. My children are English. So I have choice. Now, to the four languages I can select anything and speak, but I think the proceedings are all in English, so I have to stick to English. Okay. So recently we had this Independence Day, just a few days ago, and now we have Sevalia in 8 locations. I'm starting from 8 a.m. in the morning now. The WhatsApp messages are coming at each location, the flag raising was going on. Our oldest center is in Kasuba village near Tirudimbrovu, Tirudimbrovu district. So I was present in that Kasuba village. We had 3 chief guests on that day. One is Dr. Narmada. She has recently completed MBBS and she is just going to start working as a doctor. Another chief guest is from Ilayaraja. A software engineer in CAP Germany. And the third one is Raghavendra. He is a vice president in Standard Chartered Bank. So what is the common factor of all these 3 people? They are all alumni of Sevalia. And Sevalaya is running for underprivileged, destitute children, children from broken families, children who don't have families, and people who have been bonded laborers in bricklands and agricultural fields. So we rescue such children, and then we give them free education. We support them till the time they can stand on their own leg. So it is really very touching and heartening to see that we have created our own chief guests, right? And the people have come out successfully from those kind of background. Especially we are very proud that this is the first year that we have produced a doctor. Somebody has completed MBBS from Sevalaya school. And this girl, she belongs to a family where her father is a vegetable vendor in a village. The Parkham village is a very small village, and the vegetable vendor in that village may not be able to make a lot of profit or anything. So from that kind of a poor background, person has completed MBBS and has become a doctor now. And the story of Raghavendra Raja, he joined us when he was just 7 years old. So his father and mother, they were selling peanuts in Thirundur railway station. And at the age of 7, he lost his father. And the mother with 4 or 5 children, she did not know how to manage the family with the meager income what she was getting. She sent her first child, maybe 10 year or 11 year old, to a roadside cycle shop to become a mechanic assistant, and start earning his living so that he can be taken care of by himself. He need not go for any studies. And the other next son also went to some shop and was employed in the shop. So the last child, she thought at least this one child I have educated. And somehow people told her that there is Sevalaya, where you can go and leave the child there, they will take care of the child. So with that information, she came to Sevalaya, and she left the child there at the age of 7. And this boy studied in our school, he stayed in our hostel. We supported him for your higher education. And now he is traveling all over the world. He is one of the leading software engineers in working in Capgemini. The other guy, Raghavendra, I have to mention in this meeting that he is also a Madhawas by name, you can find out. His mother was a housemaid, she was cooking in a house, and she has also lost her husband. And this boy, at the age of 11 or 12, he was made to work in a pharmacy as an assistant. He was asked to stop his studies and go and work in the pharmacy. And then our mother also came to know that she can take the support of Sevalaya, and she came to us. And I found the boy's mark sheet, everything is above 90, maybe in class 6 or 7 he was studying at that time. So all subjects was 90, 91, 92, there is a kind of mark he has got, and he has been asked to stop the studies because she cannot support. Then we said, no, don't worry, we will take care of the boy. And he also completed his engineering, and now he is in the working in the Standard Chartered Bank in the software division, and he has come up to the level of vice president. He has recommended Sevalaya for their corporate social responsibility projects in his company. And through his company, we have been getting a lot of support. In the last 3-4 years, we have been getting a lot of support through his work. So that is the way he is trying to give back to the society. So we have lot of such examples. Many students who have lost their parents, some of them don't even know their parentage. Those kind of children, they come to us, and they have grown up in our organization. We conducted marriages for orphan girls in our premises, and the girls have been settled, and for Diwali and Pongal and all, they come to Sevalaya as if that is their mother's house, so they have to come there. So it's been going on for the last 30 years. More than 2,000 kids getting free education in our Kaswa village. And we have opened many other centers now. We have 2 centers in Ambattur, there is one in Uttaranjaro, there is one in Sri Parambadur, there is one in Tanjavur, there is one in Pondicherry, there is one coming up in Tirunelveli. So all these places we have been trying to do community college, where we have students at the age of 18, who are dropped out from schools, not so good in academics. We can give them skill training, either electrician, electrician mechanic, or beautician, or lab technician. So many courses we have opened up, and it's completely free again for the underprivileged children. And after 6 months, we tie up with the corporate, we try to get them a 1 month internship, and if they do well in the internship, they get the job there. What has happened recently is the Tiruvallur district court, so if they find any juvenile offenders coming there, or somebody below 18, even if they have committed a murder, they cannot send him to jail. So now it's very easy for the judges to put an order to go to Sevadya. So we get a lot of such children, and I can say success rate is about 50%. I can't say 100% success rate. There is no kind of children who have not used to all kind of difficult situations and all type of habits. So at least 50% they are able to convert them into good citizens. They learn a trade and they get a job. There's one boy who had about 17 cases against him. So he went through our AC mechanic course for 6 months and he is working in a booster now. As soon as he got his job, he came to Sevalaya. He said, first month's salary, I'm going to donate to Sevalaya. Now I have forgotten all my previous friends. Now I have taken a house. Now I have a mother, so I have taken my mother. Now myself and my mother, we are settled. Whatever salary I am getting, that is enough for both of us. I will not go back to my previous so we have some stories like that from junior offenders who have been converted into good citizens. We also have an old age home for destitute old people. These are all for people who are above 60, 65 age group, but no pension, no income, no family, no support. People mostly on platforms. Those kind of people have taken around 70 old people up there in Tiruvallur and in Tanjavur. We are inaugurating on 23rd and we will be taking 20 such people in Tanjavur also. We have a goshala, which is again an old age home for cows. This is around 70 cows, not eating any milk now. They are all dry cows, we are giving them as a service to the cows. Of course, because we have these cows, we are able to do organic farming. So the cows, cow dung and the cow's urine, that is the input for the organic farming. So we do organic farming in three locations. We produce vegetables and fruits, which is around 10% of our requirement. For, we have around 1,500 people taking meal every day. So we have around only 5 acres allocated for organic farming. So we cannot produce what is required for everybody. At least 10% of our requirement we are able to produce. And we are making it as a model farm for the villagers, so they can come and learn that without spending money on pesticide and whatever they have to buy, they can do completely zero expense farming and they can produce good vegetables and good fruits. So that is a model what we are trying to create there. We run a small hospital, around 1200 hospital, which is open for around 40 villages, people around Rasva village, they all come and take benefit. We also run 4 medical camps every day. 2 villages in Tiruvallur, 2 villages in Kanjipuram. 4 medical camps daily. It's a general medical camp or EAT, eye camp or dental camp, depending on the availability of specialists. We take doctors from the city and we arrange medical camps. Every day around 100 people get benefited in each village. That means around 400 people get served. Free consultation, free medicine, and also we refer to some of the hospitals where they are giving either free or discounted rates for the people who are getting efforts for the villages. So this is the services what we do in Sevalaya. So we have much more to do. We want to become our own university where we can give free education right up to university level. That's what we want to achieve, and we are trying to open more community colleges where people in the teenage who are not so bright in academically and drop out of schools, they have a chance to learn some trade and get into a decent job. So thank you again, Meera, for giving us the opportunity to have a platform to bring out Sevalaya to this group of people here. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for that insightful speech. May Sevalaya light the lamp of many more destitute children in the years to come. Our prayers for that. Thank you very much. And a model example of a family where unity in diversity. So thank you for the family members joining us on this occasion. It's my privilege to introduce Mr. L. Venkatesh. Mr. L. Venkatesh stumbled accidentally on the life history and teachings of Acharya Madhava in 2001 when he was selected to be one of the quizzers on the BBC Mastermind quiz show. After several topics were rejected for the specialist round, a book sitting in his bookshelf inspired him to take up this subject. When not at his desk in the leading design company of C.R. Narayan Rao, which was founded by his grandfather, He is otherwise engaged in quizzing, reading, swimming, sailing and traveling, usually to places that have no mobile signals. Sadly, such places are becoming a rarity. He wrote a brief essay on Acharya Madhava, which was published in the Hindu last year to mark the 700th anniversary of Acharya's Badri Pravesha. Sir, we are eager to know more about your accidental journey into the spiritual realm. We welcome you, sir.
So I'm going to talk about the person who started Z. You said XYZ, Sandhya. So about 701 years ago, on an evening in a small temple called Ananteshwara in Udupi, Acharya Madhava disappeared from human sight. Now, kind of a fascinating person, but before I get to it, a small reminiscence. So like I said, this quiz in Mastermind happened in 2000 and I was selected. There's a general round and a subject round. There's a general round and there's a subject round. So I had suggested post-independence English writing as my subject. And they said, no, somebody's already taken it. Then I suggested the Feluda short story of Satyajit Ray and they said, no, that's also being taken. So then I kind of got worried and said, well, let me choose saints and composers of Dvaita tradition. And they said, that's too broad a subject, we can't handle it. Now by this time, about two and a half months here of preparation is already over. So I was kind of desperate. I was kind of sitting and wondering what to do, and this book was looking out from my bookshelf actually. So I said, okay, there my topic is, and took it up. I'm not really going to talk about biographical details. You can actually Google it, there's a lot on the net. Now if you don't like to Google and you want something a little more animated, there's a wonderful animation on the life of Madhvacharya. You can just go to YouTube and say Madhvacharya animation and you can see it. It's a very nice thing. Except that Madhvacharya talks with a very clipped American accent and everybody else has an irritating South Indian accent. If you leave that aside, it's really a very nice thing, and especially for kids, it's a wonderful way to get started. So, what is it about this Acharya? So, let me just step back briefly and talk about three principal commentators: Shankaracharya, Ramanacharya, and Madhvacharya. So, when Adi Shankara was there, the 8th century. You can kind of understand that the Gupta Empire was in decline. Harsha's empire in Kannauj was on the decline. Pulakesin was ruling the south, was pretty active out here. And Adi Shankara's role in revival of Hinduism was unparalleled, because that was the time that when Buddhism and Jainism had made deep inroads into the philosophical religious thought processes, and Shankaracharya kind of set the boat right and did his bit. When Ramanujacharya came out 1,000 years ago, the Afghans were getting itchy about India and they were like kind of making their way up into Delhi. The Rajput kingdoms were in kind of disarray. But in south, they still had Rajaraja Chola, and the Chola Empire was at its peak. So Ramanujacharya still had a good secure home base. But you know, if you were up north, you would have been getting a little worried about things out there. But by the time Madhvacharya was born, the slave dynasty was already was fully entrenched. I think it was Razia Sultan who was the queen of Delhi. And this was the situation in which Madhvacharya propounded his philosophy. So it's not surprising that we tend to be a little argumentative and you know, we tend to be more than a little forceful in whatever we do. There's a narration in his life history that he was crossing the Ganges and he met a sultan. It's kind of believed that it was Jalaluddin Khilji. You see any photo of Madhvacharya, he's like kind of really strong, gradient, muscular, has a nice V and like sits there. And I can kind of imagine that that's what it requires to be able to go talk to Jalaluddin Khilji or whoever it was. We hesitate to walk with our vestis and kurmis in the road today. But to imagine that having to walk up to a sultan in that time and talk to him kind of requires guts. So, what does it take to be called an acharya or a philosopher to start your own school of philosophy. The first thing is that he was not the first, and neither is he going to be the last. Long before he did, there were several systems of philosophical thought. There was a Vedantic school and a non-Vedantic school. In the non-Vedantic school, you had the Charvakas, you had the Jains, and you had the Buddhists. And in the Vedantic school, you had Mimamsa of Jaimini, the sage Jaimini, Nyaya of Gautama, Vaisheshika by Kanara, Sankhya by Kapila, and Yoga by Patanjali. After this was a pronounced spell of Vedantic theism, and there you had the three great acharyas that I mentioned about, and apart from them was Nimbakara. Now, what does it take to pre-qualify yourself as a founder of a philosophical school? It is A, that you have to first have a disagreement with whatever is there in front, whatever is there before you. You got to write your own critical essays on the Brahma Sutras, on the Vedas, on the Bhagavad Gita. You have to write your sutras. These have to go through a system of peer review, has to be debated. The mid or the first millennium version of the nation wants to know, or the big debate. Now you don't scream about it, but you debate, and there's a very evolved system of debate that happens. You got to write books stating your position. These get debated, and if it then survives, it becomes a school of thought. So that's why I said that there were many other schools of thought which have perished, but these principal streams of Vedantic thought still continue today, which itself says a lot about the soundness of that philosophy. Now, how do you justify this, your thinking? So there again a very well established system of validation of the truths, and these are called the three pramanas, where they are called Pratyaksha, Anumana and Agama, where Pratyaksha is a very sensory way of validation of truth, Anumana is inference, and Agama is scripture. The thing about Madhvacharya which sets him apart from a lot of his other peers was he was a voracious reader. And it was this, he had a huge library, and the library led to some interesting episodes in his life. One evening his library was stolen. They located it in the kingdom of Kumbla. And so Acharya went to the king of Kumbla, Jaisimha, and said, return my library to me. And he said, okay, it's yours, but you got to debate my scholar and convince him that you are deserving of getting a library back. And this scholar was Trivikrama Pandit Acharya. Trivikrama Pandit Acharya was famous for having known 1.25 lakh books at the tip of his fingertips. If he had been living today, he probably would have been called Dri Hiki Rama Pandit Acharya. Sorry for this very bad pun, but I couldn't resist it. So there was this debate. It went on for 15 days in the temple of Vishnu Mangala. And at the end of that, Trivikrama Pandit Acharya was convinced and he became his student. His son, Narayana Pandit Acharya, was a biographer of Acharya and wrote the famous poem, Sumadhva Vijaya. A lot of poetic flourishes in this, and we tend to look at this book for a first-hand information of what we know about Acharya. It's a kind of a very interesting thing. There's a lot of things written about him, like of his superhuman strength, of his insatiable appetite, about his strength, about his being one of the three avatars of Vayu. I have this issue with kids, especially my two sons who come and tell me, like, how can you just believe this story, and what makes you think that we should really listen to this poem and be convinced about it? And I tell them that there's like myth, there's poetry, there's poetic license, and there's reality. And these are mixed together in a little soup. You got to use your intelligence to actually make out what it is. So, just take the simple example of Ramayana. A lot of people say, okay, Rama did not exist, the story, but if you go to Kodikare, Point Calimer is on the, it's at a little twist in Tamil Nadu, from where you can actually go to Sri Lanka. So there's a hillock, and you go on the hillock, there are two footsteps, and these footsteps on the stone, and they're called Ramar Padam. So you go to actually worship Ramar Padam, but if you're like a disbelieving cynic, like how I am sometimes, and you don't want to worship, and if you just think that Rama was an intelligent general who conquered a neighboring territory. What will a general do if you want to conquer? You go to the highest possible vantage point and you see what you want to conquer. And that is exactly what the Tilak is all about. You stand there and you can completely see the area that you want to cross to go to another country. Similarly, near Rameshwaram, there is a little, it's actually quite a big temple called Tirupulani. It's a very famous temple, it's a Divya Desam. And in Tirupulani, if you go, there's one shrine where there's no Sita, there's only Rama, Lakshmana, and there's Varuna. And Varuna is going to sit outside. So there's Rama and Lakshmana inside the Garbhagudi, but Varuna is kind of waiting outside. And apparently, this is the place where Varuna refused Rama to cross, and Rama took out his arrow to shoot the sea, and then he comes out and says, okay, you can cross, no problem, go ahead. You know, this story and mythology really fit in out here today. Maybe Varuna was a local, like you go to North Madras today, we find out of guys controlling the port. You can't get into Madras port without taking permission from those guys. Maybe Varuna was one of them. And Rama said, okay, let me teach you a lesson. And then they came to say, okay, let's make a peace out here. But what is interesting is, if you stand at the temple of Tirupulani on the sea, and you look just a little away, you can actually see Sri Lanka out there. So it's really not all just stories, you know, there's like strong fact lying below this. So the philosophy is a tri-subject, religion is a very tri-subject, it's not easy to do it. But unless you get into it, you can't enjoy the beauty of it. It's like, you know, it's hot summer day in Delhi, and you find a delicious jamun. You sprinkle some salt on it, and you put it in your mouth. There is no way that you can explain that taste unless you've done this yourself. I can write a 1,000-page essay and call it in Sanskrit, Jambu Phala Darshana. You know, and somebody might translate it to English and say, you know, the exuberance of magenta tongue in 1,500 words. But it makes no difference unless you put it in your mouth, you will not understand it. So, I would suggest that you all should at some point cook the bees for Bhavani, which is near Coimbatore. He did yeoman service because single-handedly this frail old man produced books on Madhvacharya. The highlight of which is his story of his book on the Dvaita school of philosophy and its literature. It's available in Motilal Banarsidas. You should all have a copy of it in your house if you don't have it yet. And in that he says, at the time of 13th century, which saw the birth of Madhva, India was torn by internecine wars in the face of common danger to our collective security. It was a time to call to halt the unconscious pessimism in the spirit of man. The community had to be roused to the grim sense of reality of the world. With prophetic vision, Madhva rose to strengthen the national character by turning it back to the buoyant realism of the Vedas and theism and an emotional interpretation of the epics and Puranas. He called a renewed faith in active theism in which man had to justify his existence, not just have blind belief in God and work for his realization of optimum yogyata as an instrument of the universal ruler. So with these words, I just conclude. Thank you very much, Meera.
Thank you, sir, for sharing those historical details, interesting facts, and valuable insights about the Venerable Sage. It is an honor to introduce yet another distinguished guest of this evening, Mr. Suresh Krishnamurthy Rao. Suresh Krishnamurthy Rao is the chairman of Titanium Equipment and Anode Manufacturing Company Limited and Chemfab Alkalis Limited. A graduate in management, Mr. Rao has over 2 decades of experience as a senior management team member. He is a second generation entrepreneur leading the Chemfab team group. The company that is heading now have pioneered many technologies in India with their positive impact on environment and energy conservation. He is responsible for introducing the CEC Vitac technology in the country at Chemfab Alkalis Limited. Mr. Rao had co-founded the entrepreneurs organization Chennai chapter and served as its chapter president. Sir, we now request you to share your successful corporate experience with the audience.
report.
Good evening, dignitaries, the dais, ladies and gentlemen. I acknowledge, can you guys hear me?
Yes. Yeah. Yeah.
Acknowledge the presence of my mother, Padma Krishnamurti Rao, who is, thank you, and my second son, Chandra. Meera madam had actually asked me to talk about dad's success story, so that's more interesting to talk about that. So, father was born in a middle class family. Granddad was a lawyer in Coimbatore. So, even at school, he was a very average student, but he always made sure that he surrounded himself with all the toppers of the class. So, he won't have books, but then what he will do is when his friends are studying, he will sit with them, hear them talk, ask questions, what they say in Tamil as Kelvinya. So school happened and he went into PhD. He was the first batch of pre-university to enter into PhD. He finished his engineering and freshly minted engineer, so granddad told my dad, we need a porch for the front of the house since you're an engineer. He's a mechanical engineer. Since you're an engineer, why don't you design it? So he made a design and very proudly, he got out of a fabricator in Coimbatore, gave the design and said, I want this done, please set me out. So, this was Everest Engineering. The person he was talking to was a proprietor, Mr. Somasundaram. He's basically a blacksmith, he's not an engineer. But, so he went to the design quickly and he told him in Tamil, Thambi, idu yaar design panna? Na dhaan panna, Thambi enna padichirukkeenga, na engineer. He said, if you go ahead, if I go ahead with this design, the compound wall will fall within a week. So freshly minted engineer, hot blooded, he was totally taken aback and humbled. So he found out more about the gentleman and he joined him as a project manager. So in PhD he learned engineering, he studied engineering, and with Mr. Somasundaram he learned engineering. So that's where he honed his skills. So, from there, he went to BHL, he started as a sandblasting contractor. For those of you who don't know what a sandblasting is, it's a horrible thing, a lot of pollution, not an easy thing at all. And from there, slowly, he moved into Chennai, married to my mother then. And it was then that MGR introduced the entrepreneur scheme where SBI gives you a lakh of rupees without any collateral. So, he got that. And he set up a unit in G12 in Ambattur Industrial Estate. Started to make non-ferrous equipment, that is basically copper flexibles. So he had a friend, Mr. Punjab Kishan, who was working in TI cycles. So every evening he used to spend time with him. So Mr. Punjab Kishan was responsible for the electroplating unit. So one day Mr. Punjab Kishan was very sad. So he asked, dad asked him what happened. So he said, look, the electroplating unit which imported from UK, it's not working properly and I have a big schedule to maintain and I'll be in trouble if I don't make it. Then he said, why don't you explain to me what the issue is, let me try to repair it and see. So reluctantly, Mr. Punjab Vision explained everything. So basically, it has the anode and the cathode, and there's the path, and then it gets electroplated. So the anode was the problem. So Dad said, why don't you give me one set, let me try. So reluctantly he gave one set. So he did some trial and error, studied about the material, took him about a week or so, he repaired and gave it back. So when Mr. Punjab Kishan tried to see whether it works or not, it was working. He was very happy. So he said, you have saved me a lot of trouble because, you know, those days in the 70s, by the time you order from UK, it has to come by ship, it will take time. So everything was good. So he told dad, why don't you raise a bill? He said, no, it's a friend. I help. He said, no, you should raise a bill. He did not know what to put. So he just put 5,000 rupees and just gave a bill. So Punjab Kishan scolded dad. He said, do you know the value of the material? Do you know how much money you saved for me? He said, no. Then only he realized the value of the material. That material was titanium. So having to come up with titanium, father guru was Nyananda, Taponam Nyananda Swamigal. So, just digressing a bit. So, father was noticing that his growth was a little more, exponential. So he wanted to know, everybody works hard, why is this, I'm getting this special thing or whatever. So he found out from a Nadi Joshiyar that the guru who blessed him in his previous birth is still alive in the physical form. So he and my uncle, Gopinath Rao, my uncle was crazy about astrology those days. So they took the car, both of them didn't know how to drive, they picked another friend who knows how to drive. They went to support him. And when Nyananda Swami saw Dad, he spoke in chaste Tamil, "You have come." So he said, "Vitta Kurai, Tatta Kurai, Pohattam. Let bygones be bygones, let us continue from now." So, to cut the story short, Nyananda Swami told my dad, "You are going to come across a space age metal. So when you come across that, do research on that and start a fabrication industry based on that." So, at that time itself, in the 70s, we were told that Nyananda Swami was 300 years old. So when this came about, he was totally tickled. So he found out that coating technology is available in Sikri, in Karaikudi. So he purchased the technology paying royalty to NRDC in Delhi. And that's how titanium equipment was born in 7777 in Mandalore. So from the anode is basically caustic soda industry. You have an anode, you have a cathode. Simple electrolysis, you produce caustic soda. So we make the anode. So that's how we started the anode. So from slowly from anodes went into equipment, pumps, valves, and the rest is history. So while all this was going, he used to travel to Japan. And then he saw that there was a good desalination technology. We had Madras, as you all know, had water problem. So he said, "Why not bring the desalination technology here and put it up as a demonstration plant? Maybe the government would be interested." So he got the 50,000 liter per day plant, put it up in the Marina Beach. Maybe somebody would have seen it, just next to the lighthouse. And right from PC Alexander, everybody came. Very clean technology. It works, so no issues. But of course, for various reasons, the government didn't go ahead with that. And about 5 years back, Vatek has put a similar plant in MLE. So when the government asked him to remove the plant, he did not know what to do with the plant. So as a social objective, he started making drinking water. So we introduced sachets, then we introduced PET bottles. That time PVC bottles with a distillery was there, so he didn't like PVC. So he introduced PET. And when he went to US, he found those bubble tops, you know, we call it 5-gallon. So he got that, he introduced that as well. And now another trip of his to Japan, he saw this technology called membranes and technology to produce caustic soda. Quickly, caustic soda you can produce by graphite technology, mercury technology. Both, as you, from the name you see, it's very polluting. So the membranes and technology, it's a green technology, saves a lot of electricity. And Japan had developed it because of Minamata disease. What is Minamata disease? Mercury was let into the Japanese sea, fish ate the mercury, fish died. So Japan being Japan, they took that very seriously and said, close down the plant, and necessity being the mother of invention, they developed this technology. So he was very tickled, thinking that, let me take this technology and go back to my customers, and then give this technology. But then our customers, there was no mandatory environmental requirement. So, and they scoffed it off as a laboratory lab experiment. So he said, okay, why not we put it up? So when he was thinking about this, Pondicherry government had invited him. So he thought initially he'll start with a 15 tons per day plant. That's nothing. So he started with a 25 tons per day plant. That was in 85. So that's how Chemfab Alkalis Limited was born. So after Chemfab Alkalis was set up, the government of India passed a rule, rather a GO, saying that all future caustic chlorine plants can only be membrane cell technologies. So, Chemfab has received a lot of awards for power conservation, energy conservation, and also continues to receive a lot of awards. Even last year, we received over 9 awards. And after that, so he became a Singapore citizen. So, he was alone there. So, he was managing on his own. So, I decided I got married and packed off my mother to Singapore so that he'll have some company and some good food. All said and done, wherever Dad goes and travels in the world and comes back, even at 1 o'clock in the night, my mother will have தாளிச்சு கொட்டின கர்ட் ரைஸ் வத்த கொண்டு ஆர் மாவுடு தட் ஹேஸ் டு பி தேர் வெரி சிம்பிள் எனிஒன் ஹூ மேக்ஸ் ஃபர்ஸ்ட் ஆஃப் ஆல் தி ஃபுட் இஸ் ஈதர் மை கிராண்ட் டாட் ஆர் மீ ஹி வில் நாட் மேக் ஃபர்ஸ்ட் அட் ஆல் ஸோ சிங்கப்பூர் he developed something called ultra filter membrane so there's something called NSTB national science technology board so there he got a 2.2 million singapore dollar grant so they heard him he was a doctorate from Pilani then so he became a doctorate before I became a graduate so I didn't take the competition I go on my own pace I can't compete there's no competition at all so he developed the technology there with stalwarts like Dr. Sauri Rajan who was responsible to I'm getting it technically here was responsible to develop the flat sheet membrane so if you take any book google flat sheet membrane Sauri Rajan his name will be there so once the pilot scale was established he transferred that technology back here to Chennai found a company called Membrane High Tech and CPCL's first zero discharge plant was supplied by membrane like 150 meter cube plant per day on nomination basis very difficult for our central government to give a nomination basis because we did trials we proved to them the benefits of the technology and then went ahead with it so if you were to ask me how was he successful What are the secrets? I would say hard work. Hard will look soft in front of your head. He used to work so hard, he used to sleep only 4 hours a day, 4-5 hours. I used to sleep for 9 hours. He will come at 1 o'clock from Singapore, those days the flight will come at 1 o'clock. 5 o'clock, man is up. So hard work, perseverance, unquenchable thirst for knowledge. He used to learn. He got his PhD when he was 54 or 55. To do a PhD, you need an MPhil. He did his MPhil. And then he did his PhD from Bix Pilani. And then his handwriting was so bad, sometimes he'll find it difficult to read. So he said, if I know the knowledge, but if your lecturer, my professor is not able to read my handwriting, you fail me, my efforts will lose, can I at least dictate? He said, that's a good idea, Mr. Rao. For the next PhD thesis, you will do that, but you have to write. So I think that's about it. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for sharing the success story of your father. It was hard work, perseverance, and unquenchable thirst of knowledge. And 7777, a red letter day in your lives. Thank you so much. It's time to introduce the author. Mrs. Meera Raghavendra Rao is a freelance journalist, author, blogger, and prolific writer. Her works of fiction and non-fiction include Spirit of Chennaiites, Chennai Collage, Journalism, Think Out of the Box, Three Ease of Travel, a coffee table book with 120 photos clicked by her, Slice of Life, Sequel, Feature Writing and Madras Mosaic. With more than 2,000 articles that include features, interviews, book reviews, humor, satire and travel, Meera is a household name in the Hindu, Femina, Women's Era, Caravan and Eve's Touch. Her middles about her mother and meeting Dada Vaswani appeared recently in the New Indian Express. Besides these, she has interviewed several achievers on All India Radio and television. In turn, has been interviewed by leading newspapers and television channels. Her e-journal, justlines.wordpress.com, has crossed over 81,000 hits. Madhawas of Madras is the revised edition of her 10th book. Ma'am, we are waiting for the moment when you can share with us what motivated you to come out with the revised edition of the Madhawas of Madras.
Good evening, Abby. I hope you don't mind if I sit and talk. Thank you so much. I think I'll start thanking everyone because at the end I might miss out on certain names. So let me first thank the MC for agreeing to Hema, Ravi, and I must thank her husband especially for taking photographs and so much of offering so much cooperation, support. Here I wouldn't hesitate to confess that my husband does that a lot too, otherwise I wouldn't have been doing so much. Alright. So, he's here, Dr. Raghavendra Rao. Now I really do not know where to start. First, I think I should take up what Sandhya has observed. I do agree there are less women in the book. Probably when I bring out the second revised edition, this is the first revised edition, then I think I'll have to scout for women, more women achievers among Madhawas. So, and some of the achievers are no more. So it's really, and I really didn't know how to contact the families because I didn't know anything. I had absolutely no clue as about the children or the grandchildren. So it was easier to lay hands on the male achievers, living or non-living, and contacting their families. So that's how we were able to put together some of them. Now talking of D.N.K. Sharma, I think Venkatesh has mentioned this book. I started the introduction with Sri B.N.K. Sharma. I think you mentioned that. I have also acknowledged. Sri B.N.K. Sharma, author of 23 books on Eastern thought and an authority on Sri Madhvacharya, said about the book, this is the title, Wonder of the World, written by Joy Abraham Verghese, published in 2003, which I am reproducing here. The Wonder of the World is an epoch-making and breathtaking treatise. Among Indian thinkers, Verghese is much inspired by the great theistic philosopher, Sri Madhvacharya. I made him Mr. Sorry. I've learned a great deal from this giant works, says B.N.K. Sharma, author of 23 books on Eastern thought and an authority on Sri Madhvacharya. Sharma quotes Verghese, very important observation. Every 1,000 years or so, there comes a thinker whose life is as striking as his or her intellectual output is stunning. Viewed from this perspective, it is remarkable indeed that within a period of 300 plus years, the world was to witness the convergent odysseys of four titans of thought who set the agenda for the study of reality at every level. This is the period I like to call the golden age of human thought. Between them, Avicenna of Persia, 980 to 1037, Moses Mariamonides of Egypt, 1135 to 1204, Thomas Aquinas of Italy, 1225 to 1274, and Madhvacharya of India. He mentions Madhvacharya when he wrote his book about the golden years. He mentions Madhvacharya, 1238 to 1317. He created a magnificent monument of thought that underpins the very possibility of the scientific enterprise. It is the mother of all theories of everything, one that is validated both by its inherent logic and success of modern science. Since Venkatesh has mentioned that, I thought I should share this with you. Now, coming back to, first let me thank all the speakers for giving complete perspective about what they're doing. And to talk about my first edition, I must thank Shakuntala and Raghunath Rao who are here. They're right at the back. Please stand up. Shakuntala, please stand up. I owe a lot to Shakuntala because when I wrote the first edition of Madhawas of Madras, it was something like fixing the venue of the wedding and arranging for the cooks, catering, and having a music concert for the reception, but still searching for the bridegroom. It was exactly, I was exactly in that position because Ashwin is here, I think, the director of Odyssey. He had scheduled my book launch and he had given me just 6 weeks time to complete the book. So you can imagine, within 6 weeks, how much could I really gather data, putting it together. So it was a real hurried job, racing against time. So I was thinking, how am I going to, it's not into a religious book, it's called Madhawas of Madras. So where I wanted to talk a little about Madhvacharya, give a brief introduction about him, and then select some achievers who made a mark in their respective field in Madras. And then I started looking through all the Madhvacharya collection, the books which I have, and then I thought it was like an ocean. How am I going to put all this together in just a week or two weeks' time? And then Shakuntala came to my aid. I thought it was just Madhvacharya's blessings. She said, well, I have got all that together. I've done something for my son. I wanted them to read about Madhvacharya. So I've got everything in condensed form, in small chapters, about 16 of them, right from his birth to the time he has disappeared. So I can pass it on to you. It was absolutely God-sent. I really owe it to her for coming to my aid. So that had really lightened my task. So the first part of the book, about one third of it, is about Madhvacharya, and the next, I'm bad in maths, after one third, how much is it? Two thirds? Okay. The rest of it has got about 33 eminent Madhvas who have contributed in their own field. So that was the first book. And then what happened, to go back to 2016, PS Higher Secondary School, you all know about PS Higher Secondary School. Mr. Gopalakrishnan, he's an IPS officer, but he's a retired IPS officer, he's doing a lot of service for the school. So he approached me, he said, we already had a talk on Shankaracharya, and there was someone who spoke about Ramanujacharya, so there was no one to talk about Madhvacharya, and I stumbled on your book, so why don't you talk? And when he mentioned the first two celebrities, or call them spiritual people, they were too big for me. They're absolute scholars. So I said, you're going to ask me to talk about Madhvacharya when you have already had two scholars talking about the other two saints, and I'm a nobody. Then he said, you have written a book. I said, okay, I've written a book. Let me just go through whatever I've written. And I gave a talk at PSI Secondary School, just after my book came out. And there were about, I think, 100 plus boys, all of them were boys. And so when I saw them, they were fidgeting with their mobiles, they were playful, and you know, they were not at all serious. So I said, what am I going to talk to these children? They were all, you know, just about 15 plus teenagers. So I thought, I'll have a bait for them. So I told them, here I'm going to talk about Madhvacharya briefly and also mention a few of the eminent persons I've covered in the book. At the end of it, I'm going to conduct a quiz and I'm going to give you prizes if you give me the right answers. So that was the bait, and it worked. So 1 hour of my talk, there was absolutely silent at the end of it, and I also had another vested interest. I said, I'm going to give the books which I have written. So I took about half a dozen of the different titles I had written, and believe me, all the questions they answered absolutely right. So that was a bait. They knew that they were going to get a prize. And at the end of it all, I said, thanks a lot. And the prizes were not enough because there were too many winners. So I had to, and the school had to give some books of their own, and that's all. Then I knew that. And a lot of people, you know, they started saying, we didn't know anything about Madhvacharya until we read the book. You have given it in a very condensed form. And they had repeated Odyssey, thanks Odyssey, they had given repeated orders. So I thought, you know, let me bring out a revised edition of the book, because it seems to be doing well. And let me do a more leisurely job. So what I did, I retained the first, the 15 different chapters of Madhvacharya. But I just changed the introduction a bit, changed the preface, and I just read out about Burghese. So that was a revelation I didn't know when I was doing the first one. And then I had added, I think, a substantial amount of achievers in their own field, about 17 of them, so maybe 50. So 33 and 17, there are about 50 eminent Madhvas in this. and how did I select them? Well, it was as Mr. Murali has pointed out, it was just word of mouth. It was all through contacts. Otherwise, then I wouldn't have known that. So actually, it's not exhaustive. That is, I'm sure that there are much, there are many more which I have not covered. So this time I had about 2-3 months time. So within those 2-3 months, I was able to include 2 or 3 more categories. One is music, the drawings of music, and here I must thank Purna Pratnya Sandhya Vandana for that. You all know he's a famous musician, very a purist in his performance. So he figures in my book. And so as I was talking to him, we were talking about Mr. Sudarshan. He said, you have not included Vasudevacharya of Kalakshetra. I said, okay, I'm going to do it this time. And then Mr. Purnapratna helped me in getting the foreword. Someone has written a foreword to Vasudevacharya's collection of 17 Kirtanas, Vasudeva Kirtana Manjari. So he have written, that was in 1928. So he gave me that material. He dished out, you know, dug out from his father's collection, and it's so kind of him, he brought it home as a lost copy. So I used that. So there are the section on drawings of music has got Vasudevacharya and Sandhyavandanam Srinivasarao. He's also a drawing, and a few others I've included. And another section which I have included is about film stars. In fact, to relate an experience of mine, when I launched, before I launched my first book, I was prompted by my experience with regards to my first book. Mr. Muthaya was talking to me, and I was talking in Kannada with my husband and Telugu with Mr. Someone else. And then he said, Meera, what is your mother tongue? So I said, both. He was intrigued. He said, what do you mean both? Mother tongue is the only one. I said, no, we are Madhavas. We have Kannada speaking, Marathi speaking, Tamil, Tulu, you know, all that. So it didn't make any sense to him. He said, who is a Madhava? So I said, okay, if I have to explain to him who is a Madhava, I should think of someone who is known to everyone. So I said, have you heard of Shauka Janaki? He said, of course, a veteran actress. She's a Madhava. So that made some sense to him when I said Shauka Janaki is Madhava. And then, have you heard of, you know, Badrinath Chanta Mesralaya? Yes, of course, everybody knows. It's a household name. I said, he's a Madhava. And Jammi buildings. I said, Jammis are Madhavas. But I thought they're Muslims or something like that. the name sounds so different. You mean to say Jammis are Madhavas? I never thought they were South Indians at all. But I said, no, they are Madhavas. So I just read out a few names. And then I said, come on, I must write a book on Madhavas of Madras. And I'm not competent to write about Madhvacharya because they are great readers. Spiritual leaders who are more competent have written religious books. So I thought, let me bring out the eminent persons who have contributed to the to society of Madras and in their own way. So I just selected them at random, and this is how the first book came about. And so that had become quite popular. My revised book has come out. So I suppose that answers the existence of the second one coming into the being displayed here. If you have any questions, we'll be happy to answer, any of us. You can direct them. Any questions? Yeah, Shakuntala, I'm so happy that she's come. They stay very, very far away. And Mr. Madhva Moni.
Madhva
Muni, Madhva Muni, Rao. He's come from Bangalore. He's timed it in such a way that he could be present here. I'm so happy about it. Thanks to you. To Sandhya Vandanam Rao's son, who lives in Bangalore. And that's Sri Pratnya Rao, Purna Pratnya Rao.
That's also Acharya's name.
Acharya, yeah. So we're all Acharyas. So you have any questions? And I must thank Chitra, being a Sunday, I had to pull her out to receive the first copy. Yeah, if you have any questions, you're welcome. Any doubts, any questions? Any of the speakers here?
The one, the young lady over there. I'm going to wait to read the book. You have to read the book. Okay. So it's been wonderful because I've actually, I have very little insight on who Madhavacharya is actually, to be very honest. And this whole gathering is quite insightful. It's quite enlightening to just find out who he is and what he's done. I've never really had an exposure. It's really nice and I'm actually very curious to know more. So I'm waiting to get my hands on the book. That's pretty much what I can say right now. And thank you for introducing me to this world. Thank you.
For asking me, I have to think for it. Please for the senior citizens.
Regarding the coffees, you could just let them know.
Yeah.
Discount and how much discount they're offering.
Sorry, are they offering some discount?
So copies of the book are available with Odyssey. In case anyone wants to get copies autographed by the author, please collect it at the event and get it autographed by her.
Thank you. Thanks a lot.